Well, hello, hello, hello. This is Lee Lowell from smartoptionseller.com. How's everyone today? It is Saturday, February 13, 2021. Welcome to another edition of my Saturday YouTube videos. Today, we will be talking all about Bitcoin. It is a huge topic right now. I'm really excited to discuss this today, especially because Bitcoin options trading has really begun to take form, and I'm super excited about that. But in addition to that, we will be talking, it's all about Bitcoin, cryptocurrencies. What are they? Where are they? How do you trade them? What can you trade? Can you do it over your phone? Yes, you can do it over your phone. And we're going to talk about the exchanges where you can trade Bitcoin, the brokers where you can trade Bitcoin, some stocks that are Bitcoin related, and just it's all about Bitcoin today. I get so many questions, so many emails. People want to know about Bitcoin, what it is, how they can trade it, especially since it's back in the news these days. Bitcoin's traded almost up to $50,000 per coin just this week. So it's getting a lot of attention again. It had a lot of attention towards the end of 2017, 2018. And we're going to look at charts. We're going to see where things are going. We're going to look at some of the mainstream cryptocurrencies. But first, we have to talk about what they are. And we're going to go through all of that. And then a little later on in this video, of course, we do our Saturday synopsis, where I look at the stock charts of the stock market and see what happened in the stock market over this past week. I'll look at some individual stocks, and we will see what could be coming forward for next week's trading. But today, like I said, it's all about Bitcoin. So let's go. Let's get started right now. What you see in front of you is a price chart for Bitcoin itself. The symbol for Bitcoin is BTC. Now, what is Bitcoin and what are cryptocurrencies, and you know, why do we want to talk about it? For some of you that are in the know, Bitcoin and other related cryptocurrencies, they're called, is just it was created in 2008/2009 by really an anonymous person called, I'll give you the name right here, by Satoshi Nakamoto. Now, if you want to learn a little bit more about Bitcoin, more than what I'm telling you today, you can always just do a Google search. You can go on Wikipedia. This is a Wikipedia page right here. Okay. But it was really created out of the need or the want to have another source of digital currency or digital money other than countries' fiat currency, meaning US dollars, Deutsche Marks, British pound, the euro, whatever. And all those fiat currencies are basically manipulated by their governments, right? They could print as many dollars as they want, and the buying power of the currency of your home country can move up and down. It's buying power over other currencies in the world, and just the general buying power to purchase products. And this anonymous person wanted to create a digital currency that has free rein outside of government control, and possibly use it as a way to buy and sell things, and as a storage value, like gold, okay? Something that can store value. And as we've seen over the years, the price of Bitcoin is extremely, extremely volatile. It fluctuates higher and lower. And so over time, now this is a long-term chart of Bitcoin that I have in front of me here and that you can all see. So it was created in 2009, and this chart goes all the way, this is a five-year chart, so it goes back to about 2016 or so. But obviously, you can see here, up here on February 13, 2016, Bitcoin was worth about $405 per coin. Now, prior to that, in 2008, 2009, and this chart doesn't go back that far, Bitcoin was trading for less than a penny. I mean, it was really just fractions of a penny itself. And I think the story of the first purchase of a product using Bitcoin was a guy had a pizza delivered to his house. He had to use maybe hundreds of Bitcoins just to purchase the pizza because Bitcoin was worth less than a penny at that that time. So he had to use hundreds of Bitcoins just to pay for pizza. But as of today, with Bitcoin, you know, close to $50,000 per coin, those 100 Bitcoins that he used to pay for the pizza would be worth hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars today. So Bitcoin is extremely volatile. It moves up and down, but you can see here, it really didn't go. It still had value. It started at $400 a coin in 2016. And as I move along the chart here, you can see in 2017, it really started to take off. I really started hearing about Bitcoin probably around 2015, 2016, but I really started to follow it in 2017. And you can see it started to break into the thousands of dollars here. And then 2017, when it started to hit the mainstream and you started to hear more about it, its price obviously started to go up. And then it hit an all-time high back then on roughly in December 2017. It went over $18,000 and it hit $19,500, almost $20,000 towards the end of 2017, December 2017. And then it just went on a nosedive. It went all the way back down. You know, that's what happens with these things. You know, everyone gets behind it. Everyone gets real crazy about it. And then all of a sudden, it just takes a huge nosedive. People are, you know, saying Bitcoin's not a real thing. You know, it's never going to survive. It's a scam, whatever. So the price started coming down. And you can see it started to trend all the way down. 2019, it got back to the lows into the 3,000. Still super expensive for something that you may want to purchase. Over $3,000 just for one single Bitcoin. But then 2019, it started to flatline and it started to go up again. And in the middle of 2019, it got over $12,000 per coin. And then it started to come off a little bit again. And then in the pandemic, March of 2020, that's when, you know, everything was selling off. Stock market was selling off. You know, everything started selling off, even Bitcoin. Got down in the low 5,000s around March 17, 2020. You can see the date here. And then after that, it just started to rise again. And we finally broke above the all-time highs of over $20,000 just in December, just 2 months ago. Okay, so let's see where it says 20,000. We hit 20,000 roughly in middle December 2020. And then it's just off to the races. And it didn't take it long before it blasted above $30,000 towards the end of December, early January this year. And then you can see here, it just powered up. The other day, it hit almost $50,000 per coin. So it's super volatile right now. It's super expensive, but there's calls for this thing to go up to, you know, $100,000 per coin, maybe $300,000 per coin. So it's getting a lot of interest again. What do we do with Bitcoin? What's it good for? Why do we even want to deal with Bitcoin? Well, as I said, it can be used as a store of value. You can actually buy and sell things now. You know, whether you want to do that, it's uncertain. There's not a lot of actually buying and selling of things right now because Bitcoin itself is so volatile. You know, it may seem like it's just better to hold on to it. Now, if you buy something now, if Bitcoin's worth, let's say, you know, when it was worth $10,000 per coin, it would take you a couple coins to buy, let's say, a car or something. But now when it's worth $45,000, $50,000, it won't take as many Bitcoins to buy that product. So you're really at the mercy of, well, do I want to buy this product? Because if I just hold Bitcoin instead, its value will go up. And you can buy your Bitcoin, you can sell Bitcoin. I mean, it's more of a commodity or a store of value. It's something that you want to hold on to, like a long-term stock that just appreciates in price. Now, if you ever need, you know, if you get into a bind and you have to, you know, pay your mortgage or whatever, you can always sell your stock, right? But when you do that, you're giving up the opportunity for future price appreciation of that stock. It's sort of the same with Bitcoin. You hold on to it, it goes up over time. Hey, you can sell some if you need to raise some cash to pay for things. But as of right now, Bitcoin is really more a store of value for me, something that is going to appreciate with time. I don't know if I would use it to buy a product because I know Bitcoin is still very valuable and it can go up over time. So I'd rather hold on to it than use it to buy something. But that's up to you. That's up to you. But anyway, so you have the history of Bitcoin where prior to 2017, it really wasn't getting a lot of traction. Yes, it was still over $400 per coin, expensive, but now we're, you know, up to $40,000, $50,000 per coin. So Bitcoin is here. I believe it's here to stay. Just the other day, I'll show you the article from CNBC, how Tesla is now accepting payment for their cars in Bitcoin. And they also purchased $1.5 billion worth of Bitcoin to hold in for their company, to hold in their accounts, because obviously they feel Bitcoin is just going to keep going up. So they bought Bitcoin, $1.5 billion worth, and they're going to hold that. And now they also will accept Bitcoin for payment for their cars. So, you know, you can look at this article. So there's more mainstream acceptance of Bitcoin these days. Okay, you've got companies that can allow you to buy their products in Bitcoin. There's big banks, there's hedge funds now that are starting cryptocurrency divisions in their banks and the hedge funds, and they're buying Bitcoin because they see it as a new, not so much a new form of money yet, but it can be used more of a store of a value, and if you want to buy and sell things. So Bitcoin is really coming on strong now. There's much more acceptance of it. And, you know, when the big banks and a company like Tesla start to get involved, then you know it's becoming more widely accepted. Now, the next question is, well, how do you buy Bitcoin? Where do you do it? You know, a lot of you may already be doing this. So this may be old news for some of you, but for some of the newer people out there, just wanting to start to get involved with Bitcoin, there's a few things that you need to know. I've got my cheat sheet here. Now there's tons of what they're called cryptocurrencies. There's tons of these cryptocurrencies, and they all have, you know, they all are supposed to have some kind of usage. Okay, they're good for something. Now, Bitcoin, and there's the big three. Cryptocurrencies, as they're called, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin. These three are the biggest in terms of volume and their value. Okay, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin. Now, there's a couple places where you can follow all these cryptocurrencies. A good place is, let me show you a website here where you can track these things. Let me see, which one do I want to bring up here? We've got this one, this is the chart that I just showed you. This is from coinranking.com. Now, if we go back, what CoinRanking will show you is that you can look at all of the cryptocurrencies that are out there. And there's Bitcoin, Ethereum, you know, all of these here, they're listed here. You can see their market cap, okay? So their market cap, and they list them by their market cap. So you got Litecoin and Ethereum and Bitcoin. Those are the three, I'd say, probably most popular ones. But there's obviously these other ones, Tether and Polkadot, which I don't even know what those are. But they rank them by their market cap. And that's the number of coins that are available. It's sort of like the float in stocks. You've got your float, which means the available shares. Now, all these cryptocurrencies have either a defined amount of coins in existence, or some can just create more. So the market cap is determined by how many coins are out there multiplied by their price. So Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin to me are the three biggest ones, but obviously there's other ones. And these are their current values right here. Now, if you wanted to see the chart, all you have to do is click on it. Now, this is at coinranking.com. And here's the chart. I click on the 5-year chart and it'll show you the long term. And if you hover your mouse, you'll see the current price. But there's a lot of other resources that I want to show you today that you can find all about Bitcoin and all the other cryptocurrencies. But the number one question is, how do I get involved? Where do I buy and sell cryptocurrencies? And how much is it going to cost me? Well, go back to my little cheat sheet here. So the big three are Bitcoin, Ethereum, and Litecoin. Now, the way that you can buy and sell Bitcoin is you can either do it through specific brokers, like your own stockbroker that you have, or you can buy and sell them on exchanges. Now, I've been talking about Bitcoin since 2017 at smartoptionsseller.com. There's Coinbase is probably the biggest and most popular cryptocurrency exchange out there today, either in the US or around the world. Coinbase is where I have my cryptocurrencies, where I buy and sell my cryptocurrencies. Coinbase is a great, safe exchange where you can buy and sell cryptocurrency. There's another one called Bittrex, which I also use, and Binance. So these three are right here are probably some of the biggest cryptocurrency exchanges. This is where you can buy and sell cryptocurrencies. You can store your cryptocurrencies there. And Coinbase to me is one of the best and the safest. Now, this is just, you know, this is not a hard recommendation from me. This is just information that I'm putting out there for you, for anyone that may want to buy or sell cryptocurrency. Coinbase would be a great place to start. They have an app. You can use it on your phone, but also in your brokers. Now what I will say is that each exchange here, they offer certain different cryptocurrencies. They don't offer every single one that's out there. So Coinbase, Bittrex, and Binance, some of the cryptocurrencies that you can buy and sell overlap, but some of them offer different than the others. Okay, so when I first had a Coinbase account, they only offered three different cryptocurrencies, and that was these three. You can only buy or sell these three, and this was a couple years ago. Now Coinbase offers lots of more and different cryptocurrencies that you can buy and sell. I had to open up a Bittrex account, because they offered different cryptocurrencies than Coinbase did at the time. So, and Binance offered even more. So I had to have a combination of these three different exchanges where you have to open up an account. If there were certain cryptocurrencies that you wanted to buy or sell, you had to have multiple accounts. Now, Coinbase offers plenty of the mainstream cryptocurrencies. It might be the only one you need, but that is something for you to decide. So don't use me as the last word or the definitive word on all these. You can take a look at all these: Coinbase, Bittrex, Binance, and there's others out there as well. You can do a search on those. But the big three, of course, were Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin, and there's all these other ones that you do your research on. But also today, Robinhood, which is a stock brokerage that I'm sure everyone's been getting a lot of information about these days because of the whole GameStop situation. But Robinhood does allow Bitcoin buying and selling. I don't know how many different cryptocurrencies Robinhood allows. TradeStation is another broker you can use to buy and sell cryptocurrencies. Once again, I don't know how many cryptocurrencies they offer. You'll have to dig into that information yourself. Now, other brokers like TD Ameritrade and Charles Schwab, they don't offer the ability to actually buy and sell the cryptocurrencies themselves, but they have futures contracts on Bitcoin. So you have the actual coin themselves and you have futures contracts that trade on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange. So TD Ameritrade, Charles Schwab, they only offer the futures trading on these currencies. So it's a little different than the actual coin itself. I don't play in the futures market. At the moment, I only stick to buying the actual Bitcoin or Litecoin or whatever itself. So you've got Robinhood and TradeStation where you can trade the Bitcoin. Then you have these that trade the Bitcoin futures. Other places that you can buy and sell Bitcoin and a couple others is the Cash App and through PayPal. Let me see what we have up here. So the Cash App, do I have that up here? I don't know if I have the up. Hold on a second. Let me show you the Coinbase. Let me show you what you could do with Coinbase, and then I'll try to get back to the Cash App. But Coinbase, if you're looking to open up a Coinbase account, I will put a link in the description below this video where you can use my referral link if you wish, if you so desire, to open up an account at Coinbase. When you deposit, I think it's your first $100. We each get $10 worth of free Bitcoin. So it's a little incentive, a little bonus for you to open up an account using the referral link that I put in the description, completely up to you. But what you have to do is when you open an account at Coinbase, for example, you open an account and you know, you fill out the information, and you have to deposit US dollars or your own base currency, whatever country you're in. And then you can start to buy and sell the Bitcoin or whatever coin that you want. Now, you don't have to buy a full coin. The great thing about buying and selling cryptocurrencies is that it's dollar-based, the amount that you want to buy or sell. If you want to buy $5 worth of cryptocurrency, you can buy $5 worth of cryptocurrency. It's not going to get you a lot. It's going to give you fraction of a coin, but it's something to get started. You can, put in $100 today, buy $100 worth, and that'll get you, a fraction. And you can do that over time. It's completely up to you. So you don't have to spend $45,000 today to buy a Bitcoin. You can buy fractions of a Bitcoin. And then your value will fluctuate. If Bitcoin goes up, then the value of your portfolio goes up. So you can buy and sell in any amounts of money that you wish. So that's a great thing. Now, if you get an account at Coinbase, what you all will also be able to do is look at the this is the real-time streaming version of Coinbase. So once you open up an account at Coinbase, you can also use the Pro Coinbase platform as well. This is the Pro platform, and it will show you streaming information on Bitcoin. This is Bitcoin right here, and it gives you all the last prices that Bitcoin's traded for, and it'll show you the market size over here. Now, I'm not logged in right now, so this is just this is free information, so you don't have to be logged in to use this. And right here is, which is kind of nice, this is showing one day's worth of Bitcoin from early December through today. And if you want, you can scroll back to see where Bitcoin's been, and you can scroll down to go to a 15-minute chart if you want to see how Bitcoin has traded over the last 15 minutes. If my computer will bring up the information, here we go. So these are 15-minute charts to see how Bitcoin's traded over the last 15 minutes. Obviously, you can see it's just gone back one or two days worth at the 15-minute. You can look at an hourly chart, 24 hours. Each bar consumes of 24 hours worth of Bitcoin. So it's good. Now you can click up here and you can select the market to look at. If we want to look at Ethereum, we can look at Ethereum based in US dollars. Hang on, let's refresh the screen here. And it should bring up Ethereum. Let's give it a second. Come on. All right, so we've got Ethereum chart coming up here. Last traded at $1,820. Let's pull out to the one-day chart, the daily chart, so we can see how Ethereum has traded over time. So you can see, not that long ago, beginning of December, Ethereum was at around $500, and now it's up to $1,800. So all these cryptocurrencies are going up in price. Everything's moving up, which is a good thing. So this is part of Coinbase. So if you open up an account at Coinbase, here's the original Coinbase website, coinbase.com, and then you can use the Coinbase Pro, something like this. Now, we can look at Bittrex. Bittrex is another exchange that I had just told you about. You go to bittrex.com up here, and what it'll do is, just like Coinbase, it'll show you all different cryptocurrencies that you can look at. Now let's just click on Bitcoin. When you click on this, it will also open up to a chart that shows you real-time action. And once you're in and you're logged in, you can buy and sell right off the chart here. I'll show you that once it pulls up. So here's the chart of Bitcoin that's loading. Quite slow today. Everyone's probably trading Bitcoin right now. So here you got Bitcoin. This is, let me pull out to the one. Okay, yep. So we got back to July when Bitcoin was still trading under $10,000. So here's where it's at, 47,000 and change right now, last price of Bitcoin. Great thing about cryptocurrencies, they trade 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They never stop trading. Now, These are not on regulated stock exchanges. This is not a stock. These are not stocks. These are cryptocurrencies. And they trade on exchanges. And they trade 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. They never stop. So here in Bittrex, you can do your trading over here on the side. You can pick a price that you want to buy or sell and the quantity. And you have all the different cryptocurrencies here. So this is a nice little feature in Bittrex. So you got Bittrex, you got Coinbase, and you can buy and sell from there. Depending on which cryptocurrencies you're interested, you have to see if Bittrex or Coinbase has those available for you. So it's pretty advanced, right? So you can do all this stuff. Now, just a couple of years ago, none of this really existed. So it's really come a long way. So let's get back to our thing here. In Robinhood and TradeStation, you can buy and sell Bitcoin. The Cash App and PayPal. Now, Cash App is on your phone. It's an app. You can buy and sell Bitcoin right within the app itself. They probably only give you a couple coins to choose from: Bitcoin, Litecoin, Ethereum. I haven't really checked it. I don't use it, so I don't know how it works so much. You probably have an account that you store your Bitcoins on. It's just another way to buy and sell Bitcoin. So take a look, Cash App, PayPal. Now, the one thing that I'm really super, super excited about is the Bitcoin options trading. Now, this is, as you all know, I'm an options trader. That is my thing. Been doing it for 30 years. So when I found out that options trading was going to be available for Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies, you know, I was just like going crazy because this could be a huge deal. Now, in the research that I've done, I've only found really two exchanges where you can trade options on Bitcoin. Now, it's only options on Bitcoin. I don't think they have options on any other coin at the moment. So you have Ledger X and Deribit. Deribit, which I feel has got the best information out there, unfortunately, is not available for U.S., United States-based customers. So we cannot use Deribit, but you can use it as a way to see what it looks like. So if you're based outside of the U.S., Deribit is an option for you as an exchange to potentially trade options on Bitcoin. Now, Ledger X is available for U.S.-based customers. Let me bring up the Ledger X platform here to show you what it looks like and why I like it so much. So here's, you know, you have to open up an account at Ledger X, ledgerx.com. And to get into the options trading platform, it's called Omni. That's the name for their platform. It's called Omni. Now, the great thing about Ledger X is that their options trading, each contract, you know, when in the stock market, an option contract is based on 100 shares of stock. And in Ledger X, each option contract is based on 1/100th of a Bitcoin. So the numbers can be really small. The dollar values can be really small. And what you're seeing in front of you here is, you know, what a typical option chain would look like. If you're familiar with stock options, we have call options on the left, put options on the right, and the strike prices in the middle here. So on Ledger X, their next expiration is February 19, 2021. And here's all the strike prices. And you can scroll down and you've got the March 26, 2021 options. So they have a pretty decent listing of options. And their longest dated one is December 2022. And the strike price all the way down to 5,000, all the way up to 200,000 strike is listed. So if you want to trade options on Ledger X, you can certainly do that if you're a US-based customer. Now, what I really like is that each option contract is based on 1/100th of a Bitcoin. So the numbers that you see here, so let's just look at this February 19th, 2021 that expires next Friday. The 38,000 strike for the put options has a bid of $30 at $220 ask. You know, it's pretty wide. And these options are very new, so the bid-ask spreads are going to be very wide. The good thing is that if you wanted to sell, let's just say you wanted to sell a 38,000 Bitcoin strike put option. You click on the bid price here, and it's going to open up the window over here. Now, you can trade as many contracts as you want, but in order to get, let's just say you want to try to sell these for $100, you put in 100 contracts is the equivalent of one Bitcoin, okay? And if you sold 100 contracts, you would get, and you can put in, let's say we wanted to sell it for $100, okay? If you put an order to sell 100 contracts at $100 and it filled, you would receive $100 in your account. And as a put option seller, you would be obligated to buy one Bitcoin at $38,000 per Bitcoin. And with Bitcoin at $48,000 now, is there the chance that Bitcoin could drop another, you know, $9,000-$10,000 between now and next Friday? Sure, there's an opportunity, but if you're looking to buy Bitcoin for $38,000 per coin, this could be your thing. But you don't have to use 100 contracts. If you go down to one contract and you try to sell it for $100, you're going to receive $1. So the numbers can be very small. The numbers can be very small, and you can play with as many contracts as you want. If you go up to 1,000 contracts, you will receive $1,000 in your account. Okay, so you're trying to sell 1,000 contracts and at a price of 100, and this is how much you would receive, $1,000. And that would mean 10 Bitcoins. That would mean 10 Bitcoins. So you're obligating yourself to buy 10 Bitcoins at $38,000 per coin. So it would be a decent investment. So you have to be careful. So if you're not sure, go down to one coin, or one contract, I should say, that's 1/100 of a Bitcoin. You'll get $1 in your account, and you're only going to buy 1/100 of a Bitcoin. So that would be $380 that you would have to pay out if Bitcoin actually fell down to $38,000. I know I'm getting ahead of myself. This is a little bit tricky information, but I just wanted to show you what's available out there as far as Bitcoin options. Now, you can buy the call options. You can go all the way out December 2022, the $200,000 strike. Now, Bitcoin's at $48,000. Do you think it's going to move all the way up to $200,000 by December 2022? Heck, it might. But right now, it's costing at least $9,000 to buy one full Bitcoin, okay? 100 contracts here, let's say we wanted to buy these, okay? If you wanted a full one, you'd have to put in 100 contracts, so that, and we want to buy it for $9,000, okay? So we're trying to buy it between the bid and ask. That would be a $9,000 investment. 100 contracts is equivalent to one Bitcoin. So, you know, this is just another way to potentially, you know, trade Bitcoin options. It's pretty new. So, you know, take a look if you want. I wanted to show you Deribit, which is the other, Deribit is the other options exchange. Unfortunately, not available for US customers. I feel Deribit has got a much nicer looking platform. It's got more information. So this is what Deribit looks like. You got calls on the left, puts on the right. And here's all the different expirations. So you can just click on one, and it'll take you right to that expiration. Whereas with Ledger X, you kind of have to scroll through the whole thing to find them. And it's got all the strike prices, and it's got very deep bid and ask on each side. So, you know, Deribit is a platform, an options trading platform that you can use if you're based outside of the United States. If you're in the US, Ledger X is your best bet for looking at options trading information. So let's take another look, go back to my cheat sheet here. If you want information, you know, just plain information about what's going on in the crypto world, Coindesk.com is a great resource. Let's see where my Coindesk. So here's Coindesk.com. It's got stories, information. It's got, you know, crypto prices. Keep an eye on Coinbase.com if you want your information. What else? So there's also some cryptocurrency related stocks out there that you can also trade. They're not actual coins. They're not crypto coins, but they're stocks that are sort of related to what's happening in the cryptocurrency market. So I want to bring those up. I want to bring those up on my chart here just to show you. Now, GBTC is the symbol. This is the grayscale Bitcoin. I guess you can call it an ETF, maybe. It follows the price of Bitcoin. It's been around for a while. Let's take a look at a long-term chart here. So came out in 2015 or so. Hit the highs back in late 2017 when Bitcoin itself was trading at all-time highs. And you can see it crashed just like the price of Bitcoin did. And then in late 2020, it just started to rocket again, just like the price of Bitcoin. So you've got, here's the daily chart. So you've got GBTC trading just under $50 a share now. And if Bitcoin keeps going up, this is most likely going to keep going up as well. The one that tracks Ethereum, you have the ETHE, is the grayscale Ethereum ETF. So this is tracking the price of Ethereum. Now, obviously, this hasn't been trading as long as the GBTC ETF. And so this is tracking Ethereum. So if you think Ethereum is going to go, you may want to look into getting into this one. Now, obviously, these are not recommendations. This is not personal investment advice. This is just me showing you information. So please don't take this as any kind of recommendation. We have two other stocks. We have Riot, which is a blockchain company that is obviously Bitcoin related, cryptocurrency related. And you can just see how it's just powered higher over the last week of trading. It moved up, it started consolidating, and this week it doubled in price, $25. Now it's above $50. So Riot is one of them, and the other, Marathon Patent Company. For whatever reason, this one, people are liking this one as it relates to Bitcoin in some way, shape, or form. So same thing. It was consolidating, and then just this week, it just ramped up, almost doubled in price as well. So those are the four stocks that you can possibly keep an eye on right here. I've got them listed. You know, once again, not a recommendation, just things for you to keep to be aware of. All right. So, you know, there is your good introduction about Bitcoin, what it is, some stocks that you can look at, information you can follow on CoinDesk, options trading, these two exchanges right here. I'm super excited about that. And here's some places where you can trade, buy and sell Bitcoin. Once again, my preference is for Coinbase. If you want to open an account at Coinbase, you can use the link that I'll have in the description below. And these three are the big three. But, you know, there's so many other cryptocurrencies that you can choose from. So I'm really excited about cryptocurrency. You know, I've been involved since 2017. You know, the values went up, went down. I kind of forgot about it for a while. And then once again, of course, when the news is just everyone's talking about it, it piques your interest again. So I'm hoping for all the cryptocurrencies to go up again. It's fun. It's exciting, but please don't put all your money into it. Play with caution, use a little bit, some play money, and just see what happens. Watch it grow. All right. So there you go. There's your lesson on cryptocurrency. I hope this has been beneficial to you. If you have more questions, always email me. Let's move on to our next phase of our video, which is our Saturday synopsis, where we like to take a look at the charts, see what happened in the market over the last week, and see what's possibly going to happen for next week. Let's open up the chart of the SPY, exchange-traded fund for the S&P 500. We always look at first because it is one of the broadest measures of the overall market. We like the SPY. This is a great passive fund for you passive investors that if you're just want to get involved in the stock market and don't really have an interest or desire to researching individual stocks, the SPY is a great way to get a good broad diversification of a lot of different kinds of stocks. Yes, it's only stocks, but it's diversified amongst many different companies and sectors. And obviously we can see the broad market has just been going up since the pandemic last March, been going up. We had a very, very narrow range this week. Let me bring this out a little bit so you can see. Right here, 5 days worth of trading, very small range. But a couple weeks ago, it bounced right off the 50-day moving average. We talked about it. When you have a nice uptrending stock or index, it's got good momentum behind it. All the moving averages are moving higher. That's the path of least resistance is higher. I've been talking about this for months now. I am bullish. The market is bullish. There's really no other reason to knock this thing off its feet. You know, unless we have another, you know, major disaster like, you know, like something like the coronavirus, there's nothing to keep the market down. There really isn't. You have so many perma bears out there that always are waiting for the next crash, the next sell-off, which if we get sell-offs, that's great. It's just another entry to get into the market. So the market is going higher. Coronavirus vaccines are out. People are getting vaccinated. We're hoping by the, you know, the summer, we will be getting more into back to normal types of lives. Economies will be getting back on track. People will be earning money, spending money, keeping the economies going. So there's really nothing to derail this market. Companies are still having good earnings, and that's what drives stock prices. If a company is selling products and their earnings are rising, the stock price will follow. That's how it works. I think people just tend to see these bars on a chart as blips, like they don't think it's real things. But the stock market is made up of real companies creating real products and making real money. And as long as people are buying those products, those stock prices will go higher. So the market goes up over time. And I've shown this every time we look at charts. Here's a monthly chart of the S&P 500. The market goes up over time. Why? What, you know, what's going to derail a market long term? Why would the stock market move downwards over long periods of time if there wasn't bad things happening all the time? And bad things aren't happening all the time. We like to, you know, the news and the financial channels like to, you know, get you all geared up for the, you know, next big crash because it's good for business for them. It's good for advertisers. It's good for eyeballs. But that's not really how it is. The market goes up over time. And if you have a pullback, it's not because it's the, it, here comes the bear market. It's because markets ebb and flow, and it's good to have pullbacks, and it makes for another good entry point. So me, I'm rambling here. Anyway, the market bounced off the 50-day moving average and has moved up. Another new all-time high for the S&P 500 this week. You know, I'm staying bullish. If we get pullbacks, great. It's just another place for the next entry to keep scaling in. If you want to scale in over time, you wait for pullbacks. Let's take a look at the NASDAQ. Same thing. Going up, 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 up. Almost had, yeah, we had new all-time highs this week. You know, real, each one of these bars is 1 day's worth of trading. So, you know, eventually we're going to have a little pullback. Here's the 20-day moving average, the blue line. 50-day is the red line. So if we get pullbacks every now and again, just like you saw here and here and here, they pull back. Uptrending stocks will have pullbacks. A strongly uptrending stock will either pull back to the 20-day or the 50-day, depending on how strong the pullback is. But if a stock is in a good uptrend, look to the 20-day as your first line of support and then the 50-day. And if you're looking to get in, you can get in when it comes back down to meet the uptrending moving average line. Now, these are all simple moving averages, 20-day, 50-day, 200-day. Let's take a look at the Dow Industrials. Dow also hitting new all-time highs this week, still strong, just hugging along the 20-day moving average, pulled back. We had this little dip below the 50-day moving average, didn't last too long, as another good entry point. So the indexes look strong, the market looks strong, earnings are good, you know, the coronavirus vaccines are out. We the light is there at the end of the tunnel. You know, there's really no reason to bet against the market. Betting against the market could be very hard. It would be like swimming upstream. You want to stay with the momentum. That's the way to make money in the market. You go along with the momentum. Let's take a look at individual stocks now as we do. Those were the three main indexes. We typically look at the same stocks every week because these are the most popular. If we looked at all of them, I'd be here all day. Apple. We look at Apple. I'm long Apple. People love Apple. Apple is just slowly creeping along the 20-day moving average, slowly moving up. I wish it would just finally power higher. But, you know, Apple's been around a long time, so it's becoming a more mature company. But it slowly moves up, hugging along the 20-day moving average. You know, I'm just following it along. I know in the long term, it's just going to keep going up. They're going to keep putting out iPhones. People are going to keep buying iPhones. Profitable company, got, you know, billions of dollars cash on hand. It's a great company. So we like Apple. I can only see it continuing to go up. It'll probably hug along the 20-day moving average line for a while, maybe hit the 50-day. But, you know, if you're looking for an entry, you know, these are your entry points where it touches the 20-day or comes back to touch the 50-day. Let's take a look at Tesla. Tesla's been having a little bit of a hard time of late. It powered up to all-time highs, had the congestion pattern. Then earnings came out, went a little higher, went a little lower. I drew this other triangle congestion last Saturday, and now it looks like it's dropped below it. It's got the 50-day moving average still uptrending. It may come down to meet the 50-day moving average. Now, we know Tesla's a very strong company. People love this stock. It would be really hard for me to see this thing come crashing down. I think we're just getting a little bit of a breather here. This is not a recommendation to get into Tesla. It's just what I'm seeing on the charts here. I drew this congestion pattern. It's falling down below, but that's fine. I mean, Tesla could gain its footing and continue to move higher, but it's right now it's kind of stuck in this between $800 and $900 per share. So we'll see what happens next week. It could come down to touch the 50-day moving average. We'll see. But Tesla right now is finding a resistance around $900 and could end up bouncing in here for a little bit. So we'll have to see where Tesla wants to go. What else do we like to look at? Amazon still stuck in this channel here. I had drawn the triangle congestion pattern, starting to break out from it. So you can always change your patterns here. Like I can remove these, right? And now it's just kind of stuck in this channel. Or we can even draw another triangle pattern, connect the tops of the most recent trades, and you can connect the bottoms. So here, this will bring out the triangle a little bit further. So this is what technical analysis is all about. You're drawing these patterns. Obviously, Amazon's stuck in this wider range here, not really going anywhere, but you know, that's just what stocks do sometimes. Let's take a look at AMD. We love AMD. We've sold put options on AMD in our newsletter, Smart Options Seller newsletter. We love selling put options on AMD. Had the W pattern, was waiting for it to blast above it, just couldn't do it. Started to trade down a little bit. So we can also draw, you've got a little bit of a downtrending channel starting here, okay, which it seems to be bouncing within. The last 2 weeks, it bounced off the bottom, moving up towards the top. Now, will AMD hit resistance and start to trade down again? That's yet to be seen, but that could be the path of least resistance over the next 2 weeks or so, unless it pops above. If it can pop above this channel resistance and get above this thing as well, it's very close. If it can get above $95 or so, it looks like it may, here, let's open this up a little. Yeah, if it can get above $95, that could be the line in the sand. If it gets above this downtrending resistance, which is also coinciding with the line here above 95. If it gets above 95, looks like it could keep going up to 100 and beyond. Otherwise, it's going to hit the resistance here. It can knock it back down a little bit until it hits the bottom leg of this channel here. So it's yet to be seen. You know, obviously, I'm bullish on AMD. I'd like to see it go higher. But as we sell put options, it's not necessary for the stock to go higher. It can meander around, and we still make money by selling put options. Let's see what else we have here. let's take a look at Cisco. I had talked about last week, was waiting for earnings to come out. I had gotten long some Cisco around $45. Last week, it traded up close to 50, and earnings came out this week, knocked it back down to the uptrending 20-day moving average line, bounced right off of that, so it closed around $47 and change. So I'm still holding on. I like Cisco here for long term. I'm hoping that it's going to continue to go higher. What other stocks do we like to look at? Microsoft. We talk about Microsoft. We've been looking at Microsoft. It blew above the upper line of the channel here. And as I said, once it moves beyond a long-term resistance, it will continue to move in that direction for the foreseeable future. Microsoft looks like, you know, obviously it blew above it and it probably wants to go higher. May have a little congestion here, but the path of least resistance for Microsoft is over the long run higher. It may come back down. As you can see, the 20-day moving average has now popped above this resistance line. So Microsoft could come back down a little, but the path of least resistance is higher. What else? So I had shown, let's take a look. Oh, Netflix, we like to take a look at as well. Netflix, still in the confines of this channel here, but it is hugging along the 20-day moving average. So I'm thinking that, you know, here it could be, if it touches the 20-day, the down move may stop here, and then it can continue to go higher. We want to see Netflix move above this resistance line. Two stocks that we looked at this week that we did trades on in our spreads newsletter, option spreads. We sold some put spreads on Chewy. We sold some put spreads on Chewy this just the other day. Right here, we got in just the other day as it was bouncing off the 20-day moving average line, and it just had a nice power higher yesterday. Had a good, was up $9.75 yesterday. So Chewy had a nice move higher, worked perfectly for our selling of the put option credit spreads. We also did a put spread on Peloton, the bike maker, indoor bike maker, exercise bicycle machine. Got in just the other day as it's hugging onto this 50-day moving average. Good, strong uptrend. Pulling back towards the uptrending 50-day. Got in the other day, and it also had an $8 move higher yesterday. So we like Peloton here, hoping for it to move higher. I think that's about it. I know these videos are getting kind of long. Take a look, quick look at Google. Google just powered higher since its earnings, hanging up here. Google will probably continue to move higher. It's made this little island here, but you know, sometimes you get reversals, but Google's looking strong. What else did we want to look at? You know, GameStop, obviously we can talk about that as well. up, down. It seems to be finding some support around the 50-day moving average in the low $50 range. So for now, this could be some support here. Even though it was coming from a $20 per share price, went all the way up to almost $500, now it's back down to $50. A lot of money was made. If you didn't take your money off the table, then you gave it all back. So $50 seems to be support right here. I know downside puts have been greatly bid up for GameStop. If you've been selling some of these way, way, way out of the money put options, you've been doing pretty good, bringing in some decent money. We talked about Riot and Mara earlier in the, we were talking about Bitcoin. But I think that's about it. PayPal, the online, we know PayPal, it's great for small businesses and other businesses that accept payments. It's just been powering higher. PayPal and Square just powering higher. You know, everyone's using PayPal and Square to run their businesses. These companies are in a great sector at a great time. So PayPal and Square doing well. Once again, chart action. We've been looking at stocks that are just been going up. I just want to show you once again, two stocks, Kellogg, that you can see how the chart's moving down. Okay, you got the moving averages moving down. These are stocks that you don't want to buy as they're moving down. Yes, you may think, oh, well, it's gotten so cheap. You know, I'm going to try to pick a bottom here and buy the stock. You're just fighting it's like swimming upstream. You're going to fight against the trend. The stock's moving down. It would be silly to try to buy here until you see it actually moving up. Same thing with Verizon. This is how you do smart trading. I love Verizon as a company. I really do. But as far as buying the stock, it's not a good time for me to buy the stock yet. It's still in this downtrend channel, still moving lower. I can only see it going even lower because there's nothing that's telling me that the stock's moving up. Now, until it breaks out of this downtrend channel, you know, then I'll give it a better look. But for now, even though I like Verizon, I'm not willing to buy the stock yet because the stock price keeps going down. So these are the things that you have to look at on the charts. You want to see a chart moving upwards if you're going to get long. There's no sense of buying a stock that's moving down because you're just going to frustrate yourself waiting for it to find a bottom. And it's a wasted money at that point. So that's just my assessment, my opinion. You know, don't take that as fact. Use your own judgment. What else we got? That's pretty much it. So, you know, these videos are getting long, but I hope I'm giving you some valuable information. Once again, let's take a quick look at the index itself. SPY, once again, moving higher. Path of least resistance is higher. Use the pullbacks to the 20-day or 50-day as your entry point if you're wanting to get long, just how I do it. It works. When you've got a nice uptrending stocks, pulling back to these uptrending moving average lines is a great entry point. So there you go. That's your Saturday synopsis for today. Let's quickly, once again, take a look. Go to our website, smartoptionseller.com. It's pulling up here. If you have not downloaded or if you're not signed up for our put selling basics guide yet, free put selling basics guide, name and email address here. We'll send you a free copy. Here's our services, our two options trading newsletters, Smart Option Seller, Vertical Spread Trader. It's all about selling put options for us. It works great. We do all the heavy lifting for you. People are making decent amount of money. So we're getting great success. Look at our testimonials, and we have our one-on-one coaching. So if you need some help, hand-holding, getting started, we're good for that. We help to put you on the right path to becoming a profitable options trader. All right, well, that's it for today. Another long one, but I'm trying to get you some good information. If you like this video, give me a thumbs up, send me a comment, send me an email. Don't forget to subscribe. Hit that red subscribe button in the bottom right-hand corner. That way you will be alerted. If you turn on the notifications, you will be alerted to when this video, my Saturday videos, come out. All right. Well, that's all for me today. I hope everyone has a great weekend and a great next week trading. This is Lee Lowell signing off.